No, more. So, start. Okay. So you are able to see the screen, right?
Yes, sir.
So we were discussing this compression members, in the last class. So this Euler's buckling loads, the pi square a by l square, whatever you have studied in your mechanics of materials, okay? So that is not, you can't directly use that formula at all in practice. Because in practice you will have a lot of imperfections, a lot of crookedness, so many uncertainties will be there. So this also has to be included into our calculations, okay? So that is the first most important thing we understood in our last class. And other thing also is this effective length concept, okay? So this effective length, of course, it depends on the boundary conditions, if it is simply supported, cantilever, so these things also vary. And if you want to calculate in a multi, and of course the caudal things will be slightly more because you can't have anything like 100% fixed or anything like that. So these numbers are what the code is it gives. Then multi-story buildings, how to calculate? It's not so important as far as this course is concerned, but later on you will understand. But in the IS code I-800 Annexure D, you will get all these details itself. Okay. So then for even the single angles, how to calculate? This also has been provided in the. Then this is what we said, so the Euler's thing say, so that is not applicable, so here it is not applicable in this region. So Euler's thing is something like, upper bound kind of a thing. So which is in design, we want lower bound curve so that my design will be safe itself. So the, here also we have a problem in the Euler's, this one itself. So generally, we have to do because here it fails by yielding or something. So we do some calculations in this region also. So now that's what, so since the Euler's formula is not applicable, say, so in the olden codes, so what they used was, didn't use a Euler's code. They used some, the secant formula. This was used, and then there was Rankine's formula also. This was also used in the older codes. But now the newer codes, say, so we use this Perry, the Robertson formula, which is widely used internationally. In Eurocode also, they use this Perry-Robertson formula itself. Okay, so this formula, yesterday I have sent you a PDF file, okay, regarding the derivation of, this Perry-Robertson formula. So you can go through. It's very straightforward. You have to solve a differential equation and you have to get the solutions. Okay, so you take a column. Where, and it has initial, some slightly bent column actually, okay? Some W naught is the maximum value at the center, say. If I can represent my thing as a W naught into, that sine pi x by L, the half sine sine pulse. So you can do the derivation and you can get the deflection, that is W as, so this expression we have told. And this quantity we call as some amplification factor or something, you see, people also known as. Then we have introduced some non-dimensional terms like alpha. That is, so it is like a reference to Euler's buckling formula. How much is this value? And finally, the stress is in my member. Okay, so it has two components. One comes from ordinary compressive stress, and because you are also having bending, say, because of that slightly bent column, right? So you also have this M max, so this also will be there. So finally, this is my, the say, maximum stress inside my column, say. So this is given by this expression, okay? And if you try to plot also, this is for straight column, this is for initial bent column, say. Slowly, it approaches pi square a by l square kind of a thing, it happens, these things. So now here the most important thing, what the challenge what we faced was in reality, say. Now how do I calculate the load carrying capacity? How much load my column can carry? Okay, the how much, or what is the capacity, say. How much load the column can carry? So this is what you see we were interested. Okay, so before failure or whatever, so this question we asked actually. So I want to find out the maximum load carrying capacity of my column such that it will not fail by buckling, so that is my criteria. So now, so here, so in this expression, say, so this is what we are interested. What is the maximum load carrying capacity of my column such that no buckling happens? So this is what we are interested as a designer. So now here the problem is, you know, so this P is unknown in this expression, say. So this we are interested. So now what this Perry-Robertson formula says is, you know, so to find out P, say. So what Perry-Robertson says is, like, you know, whenever you do an experiment on a column, say, so like, you know, at the midpoint, suddenly what happens is, you know, when you draw the failure, this load versus lateral deflection. So the, here, please remember, here we are drawing this lateral deflection, okay, and this is the load. So when I plot load versus lateral deflection, say, so what happens is after some point of time, as you keep on increasing the load, the fibers here, okay, so this, you know, the yield stress comes here and slowly, you know, the yield, this portion happens up to point C or something, then it collapses itself. So this is what is observed in the experimental test. So what Perry-Robertson says is, you know, so you, this to find out this load, say, that is ultimate load carrying capacity of my column, what he says is, you know, you, this sigma max actually in the column, that is maximum stress in the column, if you can limit it to sigma y, okay, so this is the most important concept. So the maximum stress inside my column is equated to the yield stress, so you will get your P ultimate load. So this is the concept of Robertson formula. So we have a column which has some small crookedness here. So you derive the all the derivations, you find out sigma max inside the column. So to find out the design, the load carrying capacity, say how much load my column can carry, what he says is this, you equate it to sigma of y. So this is the concept behind, you know, the Perry-Robertson formula. So this yield stress, if you equate, say, so you solve, so here P ultimate load, that is the how much load, it is unknown here, okay. So this unknown, say, so all are known in this equation. So you solve this equation, so you will get a quadratic, you know, the equation you have. So you will have two roots and the lowest root, say. So that will give me the, you know, the load carrying capacity or the ultimate load actual, okay. So the ultimate load a column can carry, say, you know, this before buckling actual. So this is given by this, you know, the Robertson-Perry formula. So please understand. So the most important thing is the maximum stress inside my column is limited to sigma y. So quadratic equation comes, you solve, you will get the P ultimate or of course sigma ultimate or whatever you say, you are you know, limiting in your column itself. So this is a basic concept behind this Perry-Robertson formula. So it has so many other things will be there, like, you know, eta, gamma, you followed it, and other things are there. So where eta is, you know, W naught max, say, that is the, you know, the crookedness, what is the maximum, this one, A by A is the area, W section modulus, gamma means, you know, yield stress to Euler stress, sigma is, you know, that pi square EI by, you followed, right, that Euler reference stresses, so you can calculate from this load. So this is what, you know, the Perry-Robertson formula says actually. But in the IS codes, say, or in the codes, you know, so this is how, if you plot it, you know, the formula, you see, looks somewhere like this, okay. So now, so, but in reality, you know, perfectly straight loads are not applied, so many things will be there. So the, what the people do is the same Perry-Robertson formula only we use actual, but slight, you know, the modification is there in this Perry-Robertson formula. So whatever the expressions I wrote here, say, so expressions all are same here, but in the code book, you know, they use a slightly different, you know, the notation. So like you see, the code, what the code says is, you know, so NR, so this you know already, that is the axial resistance of my column, okay, so which is given by A times, you know, F of Y, okay. So when the column is long, say, when the column is long column, so you have a, you know, this buckling thing will be there. So what you have to do is the load carrying capacity of the column has to be decreased actually. So this we call as, you see, the reduction factor, okay. So our IS code also, we define what we call as a reduction factor, which is defined as, you know, the load carrying capacity of my column to ratio with respect to NR, that is A times F of Y, that is a squash load or something like that. So this is a reduction factor. So our IS code also gives this reduction factors actually based on the slenderness ratio and other things so that you can use in the design. Okay, so the reduction factor is provided by our IS code. Now from the CODAL also, say, they use what they call as the member slenderness. Okay, so this is anyway, you know, a pi square E by, you say, sigma CR, okay, that is comes from that Euler's buckling, but sigma CR is a critical stress inside the column actual. Then there is one more slenderness ratio we call as a reference slenderness ratio. So reference slenderness ratio, same as lambda only, but we use Fy, okay? So this is a fixed actual pi square E by Fy kind of a thing. So this we call as a reference slenderness. So this is a member slenderness is, you know, pi square E by sigma CR. Reference is, you know, sigma 1, you know, so you put Fy here. So we define what we call as relative slenderness also is defined in the IS code. So that is nothing but ratio of lambda to lambda 1. So these two expressions say, so 1 by 1 you just dump, you know, so you can write as Fy by sigma CR. So this is your yield stress and this is my stress inside my column. Or if you want to write in terms of load, say, so you can also write this as NR by, you know, NCR. So NR is A times, you know, F of Y. Whereas this is NCR, say, is A times, you know, your sigma CR kind of a thing itself. Or, you know, NR by NCR, say, lambda bar square itself. So this is a very important design parameter, relative slenderness. So relative slenderness is defined like, you know, you find out one way that is for the column. Then other one is you take substitute sigma CR as F of Y, say. So you will get another slenderness, reference slenderness. So this is the expression. Now here the Perry-Robertson formula said to account for, you know, this initial that crookedness or whatever. So you know, to account for all these things, say that is in, you know, crookedness and others, you know, crookedness, then you know, eccentricity, okay, so all kinds of all real you know, the prime situation. So Robertson is, he has done you know, some small like calculations. I think some of you have to mute your mic. You have muted, right? Okay, fine. So now to account for this crookedness, to account for this eccentricity and others, you know, all kinds of things. So he defines this eta, that is, you know, the imperfection or something, as, you know, alpha times, you know, lambda bar itself. This point two comes, we will explain later. So he has defined as alpha times, you know, some this one, okay, that is a lambda bar, the slenderness ratio. So this alpha is called as an imperfection factor itself. And finally, you know, you substitute the same equation, whatever equation, you know, I showed you here, that sigma ultimate by sigma y, say, the same expression only, if you write in terms of, you know, lambda bar, that is relative slenderness, you know, all other, you know, the new variables, say. So finally, you know, the equation, you see, you get this quadratic equation here. So this is my quadratic equation. Okay, so this equation, and then this equation, say, both are exactly same. Okay, so this equation, whatever you are seeing here, and this equation, so they are same, but you know, the slight change in the you know, the notations, the reference slenderness and other concepts only. Okay, so you solve this equation, say, so I will get the lowest root is two roots you have, the lowest root is this expression where phi is, you know, this quantity comes into picture itself. Now this lambda, this alpha, say, this is what they call as, you see, the imperfection factor. So what this Robertson did was, you know, this alpha, say, he has given some values actually, okay, and these alphas, you know, so these values, say, they reflect you know, all these things like crookedness, eccentricity, you know, these all these things, okay, perfect list, this one, eccentric loads are this one, transverse loads may also act based on some tests and so many other things, you know. So this alpha is the one which takes care into all the imperfections. See, the idea here is like this. See, suppose if the column is initially bent, say, it will be like this, okay. Suppose if the column is straight and if you have an eccentricity, what will happen to column? See, suppose you have load eccentricity is there. So how the column will bend? What will happen to the column?
Column will buckle.
It will buckle only, but what type of stresses will be there in the column? You will have compression plus. See, how many stresses will be there inside the column?
Compression and bending stresses.
Compression and bending. So here also you have compression plus bending. Initially bent, say, whatever derivation we have derived, here also how many stresses are there? Here also you have having compression, bending. So here also you have two things only. Okay, here also you have compression plus bending. See, so what this thing says is, you know, all these things anyway, you know, you can represent through this, you know, one formula itself is sufficient. That's what they say. So to account for all these eccentric, then you may have been having residual stresses also inside my column. We have already said, right, in steel, say, because of unequal cooling and melting, you know, during the manufacturing process or maybe during welding and others. So you will have residual stress also to account for all these things. So this Robertson, say, this is empirically, you know, this has been introduced in the formula, this alpha. So this take care for all these things itself. So alpha, you know, lambda bar, you know, substitute here. So you will get my x bar, this is zeta, okay, which is the reduction factor. So now the resistance, say, so, you know, the buckling resistance you can find out from this expression. So Ay is your squash load. So zeta is your reduction factor. So the load is getting reduced actually because of your slenderness or this long column. And of course, you have this safety of factor, you know, which regularly you see we use in our limit state design. Okay. So the whole thing concept boils down to finding out reduction factor, how much the load has to be reduced when the column is long. Okay. So this you don't worry. So this is, these are things valid for a Euro code. IS code also same, but we don't have like a class 4 or, you know, we take it in this one itself. Now this is point 2, we will come to that one. Okay, so the same thing I have shown here. So now, so our IS code, say, or even the Euro code also, what they have done is these are the values of alpha. Okay, so alpha is 0.13, 0.21, 0.34, 0.49, 0.76. So these values have come from, you know, the experiments. So based on lot of you know, columns and lot of sections they have studied, I section, A section, everything, so they have chosen the alpha values are like this. So based on this alpha, say, so the code has given, you see, four types of curves itself. So A, B, C, D, the column curve A, column curve B, C, and then D. So because alpha is varying for all these, you know, the numbers itself. Okay. So this four curves, you know, the this one, you know, the codal things gives. And now you can see what is the point two here. No, what is the magic number point two? What is happening for point two? So you see the corresponding y-axis, what is happening? What is the reduction?
There is no imperfection.
So there is no reduction factor. What does it tells you physically? What is the meaning of that one? If lambda, non-dimensional slenderness ratio, if it is less than 0.2, say, what does it tells you? What type of column it is?
It is a perfect column.
It is a?
It's a short column.
It is a short column, not perfect column. Okay, it is a short column. And short column fails by
yielding.
Yielding only. Okay. So reduction factor is 1. You followed. So no need to do any, simply it is as good as your tension member kind of a thing. Simply A times Fy. So if it is more than 0.2, say, so then you know, this comes. So that is why you see this 0.2 business comes into picture actually in the formula. So this also you have to remember. 0.2 is, you know, it is like a transition from this to that set. So that is how the caudal things. And our original Euro code, if you see, say, they have some 5 curves have been given in the original Euro code. You know, A0 also, they have one more curve will be there. But we have our IS code A, B, C, D classifications based on this alpha values. So this is a Euro code actually. Okay. So A0, A, B, followed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 curves will be there. This is given in Euro code. So our IS code has borrowed from the Euro code, but we have not using this A0 directly. ABCD, you know, we use this one, and this is the Euler's buckling formula. If you plot, say, how good is this formula, you know, so you can see you followed, right? Euler's formula pi square a by l square is like upper bound actually, okay, of these curves. But in design, you know, we want you know, the lowest curves itself. So that's what now the our IS code also gives a near definition. See what is meant by curve A, when it should be used. That is alpha imperfection factor, say. So this represents, you know, the hot rolled I section. Okay, perfect, quasi perfect shape, such as hot rolled I sections, you know, they have given some numbers also. H by BF, say, that is bread, you know, width of the flange and thickness of the flange. If it is less than 40, if buckling is perpendicular to major axis, you know, hot rolled hollow sections. So you should use curve A. Then curve B, it represents medium imperfections actually. Okay, so rolled I sections, buckling about minor axis, welded I sections. So they give all this type of classification. Curve C means lot of imperfections actually. Channels, angles, T-shaped sections, they come under curve C. Now curve D means, you know, maximum imperfections. So this you have to use for, you know, the hot rolled I sections with very thick flanges, thick welded. So, you know, so this type of classification, you see, our code nicely specifies which curve should be used for what type of structure itself. So now, you know, so if you see this expression, say, let us say I have a slenderness ratio 1, okay, the non-dimensional slenderness ratio. So which will carry more load actually? Now, A or D? The reduction factor is high for which one? See, the load carrying capacity of which curve will be more actually?
A.
Because for A will be, somewhere here. So D will be, very, very small kind of a thing. Okay, so that's how. So this ABCD classification comes from this alpha values. That is our imperfections, which this has come from experiments. Okay, they have tested lot of things and they have come this one. So our IS code gives a table also. In IS 800, you can open and you can see this table here. So this is an I section, say. So they give you, if thickness is less than 40 mm, so buckling, if it is a major axis buckling, say, you should use buckling curve A. Minor, say, you should use buckling curve B. Then 40 to 100, say, B. So which curve you have to use, our code, clearly specifies. There is this table is there, you can, IS 800, if you open, say, you can see this curve itself. Now, this is for welded I section, okay? So which buckling curve you should use, say, clearly the code, specifies. Suppose if it is a tubes are there, hollow tubes or something, so you can see now among all those sections, say, which have higher strength actually, which are like, more, very good buckling performance, which sections performance is much better in this table. You remember when we in the starting of compression members, I told you which is the best cross section.
Sir, hollow section.
Hollow circle. Section. Circle. Now you see here for hollow circle section. So what is the buckling curve?
A.
A. You followed. So why A? Because that equal radius of gyration, say. So it will have the more strength. Okay. Now if we say angle section. Angle sections. What is the buckling curve? Whether it's a load carrying capacity small or higher. See for angle section, say, what is the buckling curve?
C.
So these are the imperfection factors. 0.21, 0.34, 0.49, 0.76. But original Euro code has 5 curves. That's why those 5 alphas, was there previously. But our IS code takes only 4 alphas. So these are the buckling curves. So clearly, the code gives nicely these numbers itself. And in our IS code, if you see, they give tables are there. Okay. So they give two type of things. One is you can use this formula, that is, these formulas, whatever I told you, right? So you can, the alpha value, the buckling curves, A, B, C, D. So B means alpha is different, C means alpha is different. So you can substitute here. You can calculate this, expression itself, NBRD. Or our code also gives this charts, numerical charts also they give. You can pick up from this chart, or there are a lot of tables are there. If you can see the code. Where is the code? Now, so if you open this IS 800, say, okay. Now, so you can open this IS 800. So if you give this, where is compression member, section 7. Okay, so this is my compression member. So you can see same formulas, okay? So phi by phi square, lambda square, So where phi is this one, where alpha is the imperfection factor, okay? So the code gives this one. So you can use this equation to find out psi, okay? That is, psi is the most important thing. Oh, there is no God. That is, you see, this psi times f of y, okay, by gamma m naught. So this psi is a reduction factor. So you can find out psi from this expression also. That is 1 by phi plus phi square minus lambda square, or phi, this expression you can use. Or the code, alpha also they have given you, okay. So this is a design chart. So what code gives is, to be on the safe side, say, okay. So they give you these numbers also, the stress reduction factors, they will give you these type of charts. So this is for column buckling class A, okay? This is the yield stress and this is KL by R actual. So now from this chart, say, what is the yield stress of mild steel? See, what is that we are using from the in this course?
250.
250. So now you can see this column. The column for 250, you have to choose from this expression. So your x-axis is KL by R, the slenderness ratio. If you know the slenderness ratio, if you know the yield strength, you can pick up from this graph itself. And our code also gives, you know, for other yield stresses also, you know, maybe, you know, later on if you're having any materials, a stainless steel or whatever, so you can choose from this graph. So this graph is for buckling class A. Okay, then we have another graph also which says buckling class B. Okay, the reduction factors. Then then similarly for buckling class you see C will be there. Then we have buckling class the D. Okay, so four the charts are there. So you can use that itself, or you can use this itself also. Okay, so they run this also. This charts will give you the reduction factor. You can see the title table 8D stress reduction factor it gives you. Then the another chart also is there. They will give you even the design compressive stress itself. Directly you can pick from this graph itself, because when you want to do the design, say you should know the the design compressive stress to select the member. So these charts also can be used for the design. So 9 A is for buckling class A. Then we have a B for 250, all kinds of things they will give you. So there are two tables have been given up. Okay, so which gives you so if you go to above, so the two charts are there. Okay, so you can one is for the reduction factor, and the one other one is for directly the design stress itself. Okay, so that is for FCD. So directly the charts are there for FCD, then for psi actually. So directly you give it. If you don't want to use the chart, you use the formula also, you will get the same answer, or if you can pick up from the chart, because some practicing engineers say they prefer charts instead of substitution and then and the calculation and others say. So you can directly read from the chart itself. So that is what you see our IS code does. Okay, so this table also will be there. So you have to identify, and then you pick up from the chart actually. So here I'm just showing you for 250 mild steel. Okay, from the same IS code only. So for 250 say, so if you pick up all the values, so this is a reduction factor. You can see this is a curve A. Then curve FCD also code gives actually the design compressive stress. Okay, then B, then C, then D. You can pick up from those charts given in the IS code based on the slenderness ratio itself. So this also it shows this Robertson curve. So we use this lambda naught. I told you already this the plateau where short to long or something. So this expression say. So point two, you can easily find out. I already told you, right? You substitute from that, that P as that, sigma as Fy, and you can get this number. So this is a point two. Okay. So the slenderness, this one. So before, after this is say, so our buckling happens below, you have a reduction factor is almost one itself. So this also our code says with lambda less than 0.2, buckling need not be checked. If lambda is more than 0.2, say, so then you have to do this buckling classification. Say. Another thing, some guidelines, like for example, say steel, what do you mean by short, intermediate, long, so in practice, based on the curves, like practicing, they have also defined, like if a KL by R is 0 to 40, say, generally short column, then 40 to 125 intermediate, then more than 125 is a long column. So like this type of also classifications are there. They are not required, but generally, people use it in the practice also. This is how the design has to be done. So if you have to find out strength of a compression member, say, so this is expression given in the code, that same thing. So PD, that is a design compressive strength of the member. Okay, so this is given by A into FDC. So this FDC, say, so this is a design compressive strength. So you have a reduction factor. So that is this zeta Fy by gamma times M naught. So zeta, say, so this you have to find out from this expression, which comes from that Perry-Robertson formula. Okay. And this phi is given by this expression. What is 0.2? What is 0.2? Just now I told you, right? 0.2 indicates what in this formula?
Short column.
Short column. Excellent. So this you should remember. Okay. So generally, you don't need to know all the details I'm providing, but you should know how this formula has been derived and what each of them represents. Okay, so 0.2 that is short to this one, that is how this came. And other things are all same. Lambda is this non-dimensional slenderness ratio I defined already, Euler's buckling stress. So you calculate all these things, say, so you will get your this one. So instead of using this formula, okay, so this is psi, say, So directly the code gives charts. So from the chart also, or the tables, that also you can pick, or you can substitute in this expression, and also you can derive yourself. Okay. So now for angle sections, say, so there is some small extra thing you may have to do. So if you are having angle sections, okay, so what happens is angle sections, of course flexural buckling, this will be there, plus local buckling also may happen actually of the leg. One leg will be there, and the flexure, torsion, all these things comes into picture, say. So our IS code recommends, the everything is same, only the IS code recommends it's the slenderness ratio. You have to use this expression for the angle sections. Okay, so you have two more things, are the lambda square, two slenderness ratios, then the torsional buckling, then the local buckling, say. So these are the expressions. Later on when we go to lateral torsional, we will give more information about these two things also. Okay, so this you have to do, and then the slender, and k1, k2, k3 are the additional constants. So this also depends, fixed how many bolts are there. So you have to check from this table itself. It is available in our IS 800. Okay, and now let us see one quick the problem. Okay, so how to do this one. So now, so this problem is there in Duggal's book, Okay, this is a standard nice problem. So now you have to find out, say, the design compressive load for a stanchion. Okay, stanchion or columns, the word is same in buildings, So this stanchion, say, so it is, some 350, that is, ISHB 350. Okay, so this is ISHB 350. So this column, and this is a weight or whatever. So its height is 3.5 meter high. Okay, so the column is restrained in the direction and position at both the ends. So this has given the description also, that is the support conditions. So now it has to be used as an uncased column in a single story building, so this is what. Now we have to find out how much load this column can carry actually. So this is what you have to do. Okay, so the first thing, so since it is Fe410, so which means, yield stress is 250 megapascals. Because in the charts, they give a variety of like that, and safety factors, say, so gamma, m naught, so all these things you copy from the code itself. Now if the column ends are restrained in direction and position, so what will be the effective length? So what is effective length for a column restrained, say, in direction, position? You can go through that table. What is the So what is the the column restrained, say, what is the effective length? Effective length factor, what is the value?
Unsupported length.
Which one?
Half L.
K is half.
Half, or what is that value recommended by the code? See, theoretical K value is fixed. Now my column is, okay. So what is the theoretical value is 0.5, but what the code recommends?
0.65,
not 0.5. Okay, so this you have to be careful. So we have to use the caudal values. So now let us go back to our problem. So that is also fixed now. So this is my thing. So now the columns are restrained, so the effective length factor, say, is 0.6, but theoretical value is 0.5 only, but the caudal thing is 0.65. as I told you, right, you don't have like 100% perfect kind of a thing. Okay, and now ISHB 350, you open your steel tables. Okay, so from the steel tables, you copy all the information. So depth is 350. Okay, breadth of the flange is 250 mm. So all these details are there in the steel tables. Thickness of the flange, say, is 111.6 mm. Then thickness of the web portion, this is 10.1 mm. Okay, area, that is of the ISHB 350, say, is 9221 mm square. Now, apart from that, because you are doing buckling, say, you have to copy radius of gyration also becomes very, very important. 146.5 mm. So major axis, minor axis, all the things you have to copy, 52.2 mm. Okay, so these are the details of my this one. Now what is the first step? What is the first step you have to do? So you have to find out the compressive load. Okay, now these are the details have been given to you. The first thing what you have to do is
sir, find the slenderness ratio.
Slenderness ratio you have to find out, but before that you know what is that already the you have the slenderness ratio. See, height is has been given, that is a 3.5 meter high. K is also, you know, radius of gyration also, you know, you can find out slenderness ratio. Okay, but that is also fine, but what is the first thing you have to do? Slenderness ratio you will find out, that is true, but the first thing what you have to do, so if I want to use this you know the this principles, so the first thing what you have to do is
find the class of buckling.
Find the class of buckling actual. Okay, so whether it is A class, B class or something, you know, so this you have to decide. So that is the most important. But one more important thing I told you, the first thing what you have to do in compression buckling means you have to classify whether your section is compact or semi-compact, you remember, plastic or something. And we told for this one, so you should never use slender, you know, this section. That is the first thing. You have to classify, the section classification becomes very important. But anyway, since in this problem ISHB 350, you know, we are directly going that one. So anyway, so first you have to find out the buckling class. So H by, you know, the breadth of the flange. So this turns out to be 1.4. This is greater than 1.2, and thickness of the flange. Okay, so 11.6 less than or equal to, you see, 40 mm. Okay, so 1.4, 11.6. Go to that table here. So thickness of flange is, you know, less than 40 mm. Okay, so this also is perfectly fine. And H by breadth of the flange is, this should be for our problem we have got as 1.4, and we have got for this as thickness of the flange is less than or equal to 40 mm. Okay, now what is its buckling class? Now what is the buckling class of this one?
A or B?
No, A or not, A or B. Along major axis, what is the buckling curve? See, we have two, right? A is for major axis. For minor axis, you have to use, you know, the B itself. Okay, so two things are there. Okay, so A and B. So that is very important. Okay, so now here, you know, oh God. Nah. So you know these numbers of, just one second. Hello, tell me. I will call you back 10 minutes. Let's go. So this thickness of the flange is there. So now we know the buckling classes also. So Z, so which is a major axis here? We have two things actually, Z and Y. Which is a major axis? Which is a major and minor? Two are there, right, for this I section. So you have two things are there. One is, one side is 146, other one is 52.2. You followed, right? So major axis is which one?
Z axis.
So this is a major axis. So you have to use buckling curve A. For minor axis, so you should use buckling curve B itself. Okay. So now, you know, you substitute. Okay. So all those things. So now you can calculate about YY. That is minor. So YY axis, if you see, say. Of course, it will buckle in which axis? YY or ZZ? Where radius of gyration is small?
YY.
So it will buckle along YY only. Okay, so now you find out the slenderness ratio. So lambda Y, so that is a KL by, you see, RY. Okay, so 0.65 into length. So 3.5 into 10 cube by, you see, 52.2. So this turns out to be, you see, 43.58. Okay, so this is my slenderness, this one. Now for KL by RY, say, is, you know, 43.58, and the mild stress of the steel is 250. You followed, right? So now from the graph, okay, that graph, whatever, are from the tables given in the IS code, directly you can get the design stress itself. See, 43.58. okay, go to IS code, this one. So here in the IS code, say, he has given two tables. One is for the reduction factor, other one is directly the compressive stress also you can find out actually. So now if it is a FCD, okay. So now because minor axis is a buckling class B, you know, so for 250 is my this one. So 43.58, so 43.58 means somewhere, you know, here, okay. So 206, 194. So for 40, it is 206. For 50, it is 194 actually. So you just interpolate, say, linear interpolate between these two values. So directly you will get my, the, you know, the design, you see, the compressive stress itself. So from the chart, say, from the already the table, you can find out, you see, FCD by interpolation. So 201.70. So the design compressive strength, say. So the design load or design compressive strength. No need to find out any reduction factors. Directly the chart is provided in the code. So this is, you know, A into, you see, FCD. So area anyway, you know, 9221 multiplied by, you see, 201.7 into 10 to the power of minus 3. So finally, this turns out to be 1859.87 kilonewtons actually. That's all. You followed? Very, very simple. So the IS code gives, you know, because the practicing engineers say they may not understand reduction factor, you know, all those things are there. Directly they give the design compressive stress itself. Very, very easy. That's all. So this is how, you know, you have to calculate. Now for the major axis, say, not required, but you know, if you want to calculate, say, so your slenderness ratio, so this turns out to be, you know, 0.65, that 3.5 into 10 cube, you know, 146.5. So this turns out to be 15.529. So these are slenderness ratio. Okay. Now from the chart, say, so for 15.29 and 250 Newton per mm square, and then from the, now it is going to buckle under A, the buckling curve A, you have to see. Okay, the table given in the IS code. So this turns out to be the design compressive stress, say, okay, for this problem, you see, turns out to be FCD, okay, 226.447 Newton per mm square actually. So the design strength, say, so the design strength, you know, of this column. So this turns out to be 9221 multiplied by this 226.44. So this turns out to be 2088.06 kilonewtons actually. Okay. So now, so this is along the major axis. This is along the minor axis. So which is the design compressive strength of this column? See how much load it will carry now.
1859
kilonewtons. Why, which is the lowest? So, you know, so, and it is going to buckle under which axis? ZZ or YY?
YY.
Okay, so this is a very straightforward kind of a thing. So for practicing engineers, say, you know, they may be confused with all these kinds of formulas. So the code gives directly the simple, you know, the work itself. Now, you know, if you want to calculate from the formula also, you can calculate. But for that, you know, you should understand Perry, Robertson, you know, all those things have to be understood. So you can try, like, you see, YY axis, say. I don't want a design chart. If I want to write a program or, you know, the formula or something, so you can use that formula. So for that, you find out, you see, the non-dimensional slenderness ratio. Okay. So non-dimensional slenderness ratio, you have to find out. So FY, KL by RY, okay. So whole square by pi square E. The non-dimensional slenderness ratio you calculate. So 0.490 it comes. Then your 5y, say, so 0.5, you know, 1 plus alpha, you know, lambda y minus 0.2 plus lambda square y. So you have to substitute all those numbers. So 0.5, 1 plus, what is the imperfection factor? So that is also there. Imperfection factor also given in the code. So if it is buckling class B, say, 0.31. So you can use these expressions here. Okay, so 0.34, so substitute 0.4 minus 0.249, sorry, plus 0.49 square. So this turns out to be 0.669 kind of a thing you have. Then once you know 5y, so now you find out FCD. Okay, so this FCD you find out. So this is FY by gamma times M naught by 5y plus 5y square minus lambda square y whole to the power of 0.5. I think there is a square root here. So substitute all those numbers, say. So this turns out to be 202.11 Newton per mm square. So this is my design compressive stress actually from the formula. And now from the chart, what is the number we have got from the chart? You followed. So from the chart, what is the value?
201.7.
More or less, they are close to each other. But how did we get 201? Because you have done a linear interpolation. Because for exactly 43.58, you don't have answer. Okay, 40, 50, like that, the code gives. You have to interpolate. Okay. So now here, this is a design compressive stress. Now you find out the design, you know, the load carrying capacity. Okay. So the design strength of this column will be. So you multiply, you know, so 9221 multiplied by, say, 202.11, and of course 10 to the power of minus 3. So finally you get 1863.65 kilonewtons. So exactly, you know, 1859 we have got. Now from the formula, say, we have got 1863. So, you know, you take 1859 or whatever, that is anyway gives a lower bound. So that is how, you know, you have to do the design actually. Okay. So this is how, you know, you can find out from both the formulas. So our IS code gives, you can no need to look at the charts. You can directly use the formula itself. But practicing engineers practicing, right, there may be a problem for practicing engineers. Say the easiest thing is you give the charts so that they can easily interpret those charts. So directly the code gives the design, you know, the compressive stresses itself, and stress reduction factors are not required. But you can use FCD directly, you can use the design. Very, very easy itself. Okay, so you can you can practice, or you know, you can solve some problems also. Okay, so you can now you can see the or along the major axis also you can find out. Okay, so he has already in the Duggal's book, you know, he has given this things also. Okay, so you can use this and you know, you can solve many problems on how to find out the design strength. Now for the design, say, so now how do we design a column? So given a column, you can find out its strength. But if you want to design a new column, say, okay, then, you know, these are the steps, you know, you have to do it. So first thing is you find out the factored design force. Okay, working service, you know, right, 1.5 times and other things, you find out the load. Now the next thing is, you know, in practice, say, so now you have to design a column. You don't know, you know, in steel tables, you can take anything you want, ISHB or ISMB or R angle sections or whatever you want to select, say. So here, so the first thing what you have to do in design is you have to estimate approximately the slenderness ratio or design compressive stress actual. Okay, so this is you have to assume some, you know, based on the practical considerations and others, say. So this you have to estimate actually. See, like there are some guidelines given in the code itself. See, like for example, you know, they say that if you have a column from 3 to 5 meters, say, this is the height, say, like in multi, you know, our buildings we use. So generally the, you know, the guideline is, you know, you select any, you know, you assume slenderness ratio between, you say, 40 to 75. Suppose if you have a longer column, say, so you can have a little, you know, higher value can be given. Okay, and for column support, very high loads, very heavy loads are there, say, so you have to use a slenderness ratio, you know, a very smaller value can be used actually. So if the loads are very high, then you know, you decrease the slenderness ratio such that, you know, it becomes a, you know, the short column itself. Now if you are having angle struts and other things, so slenderness variation ratio is 110 to 140. So these are some you know, the design guidelines are there, how to select initially the slenderness ratio, you know, something like that. Now once you know the slenderness ratio, you find out the design compressive stress, because you know the yield stress of steel is, you know, the 250 megapascals. So you can do corresponding to the buckling class of a cross section, this you have to do. Now you know, so once you have done this one, say, so approximate, you find out the area actually. Okay, that is load divided by this compressive stress will give the area. So now once you know the area, say, so you go back to your steel tables, you select some trial section, and you know its radius of gyration and other things you calculate. Once again, now once you know the area section, now you have to do repeat the same procedures what we have done previously, and then the load carrying capacity you find out, and this PDCA, so this should be more than you know, this PU. Okay, so you have to do a, like you say, trial and error basis actually. So assume something, So start with, you know, you have to assume design compressive stress or the slenderness ratio. There are some guidelines are there, okay, based on the practicing, you know, this engineers or something. So based on that, then you select the design compressive stress, then you calculate the area, and then you do the checks actually. So you have to go back and then check, you know, the slenderness ratio and all other things. And finally, the design carrying capacity should be more than our, you know, this PU. So that is how, you know, the design you have to do. So there is an iterative, you know, the procedure itself. Okay. So there are nice problems are there. We will see maybe tomorrow or maybe followed, right? So how to do a design actually. Okay. So which is 3.5 meter long in a building, say. So factored load has been given. Length has been given. Now you have to find out, you know, you have to design what type of cross section, what type of steel table, you know, what you are going to use itself. Okay, so fine. So I will stop here. We will continue in our next class. So if there is any questions, you can ask. So if there are